Good morning and welcome to Macquarie Chapel Presbyterian Church. Thank you for joining us this morning and apologies for the delay in our broadcast. We hope that we have no further technical issues. We have had some update of equipment through the week, but we are in a better position as a result moving forward. That's our prayer. So this morning we also welcome to our service Gail Kent, who's going to be preaching from Hebrews 10:19-25, and so we welcome Gail. It's great to have you with us this morning. Thanks again to the team that is here. A few announcements about things that are happening in and around our church. Before I go to the slides, I just need, before I forget, to say that we have been in touch with Mom Parker, who many of you would be aware of the situation. We did pray for it over previous weeks. Just four things I need to say. Mon has had to leave Myanmar in a hurry for security reasons. A second thing is that God has been very good in helping that process along, but they're not quite out of the woods yet, so please keep praying for that. Thirdly, they're in the process of trying to book flights now, so that would be a good thing to be praying for specifically. And fourthly, for us as a church that supports Mon, we're going to look at raising some funds for her in the coming weeks. We hope to give you some information, hopefully even next week or the week after, with regards to what it is that we would be asking for funds specifically for in support of Mon. And so just please be aware of that coming up. The other thing as well is in the chat, if you would like to use the chat function this morning, you might like to answer the question, who or what encourages you to follow Jesus? Who or what encourages you to follow Jesus? Other announcements, very, very quickly. Meet the elders. We have Jim Hull, who's going to be joining us after the service this morning to share his answers to those interview questions as an elder of our church. I did mention DNA groups last week, and I won't talk about them more now. The other thing is Ride Presbyterian Church is the church that we will be praying for. I believe that slide has been circulating, and it will circulate again at the end if you'd like information. I know a little bit about Ride Presbyterian Church, and so many of you would know Randy. He is being employed by them while they're without a minister, so be praying for Randy and the elders. That's it in the way of announcements. I just want to read a verse or two from Ezekiel. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from all of your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I'll remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for helping us overcome some of our technical issues this morning. We thank you that Gail is with us. We pray that you would be with us, that we would have a sense of your presence. Lord, guide us, especially as we think about Hebrews 10 this morning. And pray, Lord, that this morning would be a time of blessing for each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing our first hymn. Please sing along at home. Bring to the Lord a glad new song.
Join his prayer. Good morning, everyone. Now I'm going to read the Bible from the Hebrews 10, verse 19 to 25. A call to persevere in faith. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching.
Thank you.
elect from every nation, yet one throughout the earth.
A church of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth.
One holy name he blesses and shares one holy food.
As to one hope she presses with every grace and joy. Scornful wonder, men see her much oppressed.
By schisms rent or shunned, by heresies distressed.
Yet saints their watch are keeping, their cry goes up how long?
And soon the night of weeping shall be the morn of song. In toil and tribulation and tumult of her war,
she waits the consummation of peace forevermore.
Till with a vision glorious her longing eyes are blessed.
At last the church victorious shall be the church at rest. Yet she on earth has union with God the three in one,
and mystic sweet communion with those who rest his throne.
Oh, happy ones and holy, Lord, grant to us your grace.
With them the meek and lowly in heaven to see.
Thank you. open page.
Our fathers knew your goodness, and we their deeds record.
And both to this bear witness, one church, one faith, one Lord. Your heralds brought the gospel to greatest as to
It's really good to be with you today. It's been a while since I have been at the 8:30 service, and it's a bit strange, it's a bit different, but it's really great to be with you. As we're working through this letter to the Hebrews, when we were planning this, I put my hand up fairly quickly for this passage because it's one of my favourite passages in Hebrews, in the Bible actually, and it's kind of been sticking with me for the last few years, this call to hold on and persevere in faith. In the chat, or something for you just to think through as well, is think through who or what encourages us to keep following Jesus. As we've been looking through this letter, we've seen a lot of good reasons to continue to follow Jesus. And of course, to the original readers or hearers of this letter, this was a real life thing for them. Were they going to keep holding on? Were they going to keep following this Messiah, this Jesus that they had heard about? Some may have even witnessed. We don't know exactly. But I wonder for us as well, as we come to this passage, what this means for us today. What are we holding on to? What are we finding difficult maybe about following Jesus? This passage, you can see, is there's a famous that famous line, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess." And as I was thinking about that, I'm thinking about those things that we're holding to at the moment. Maybe we're holding to vaccination rates and when we can finally go out for a picnic with more than five people. Maybe we're holding out for action on climate change or justice for First Nations peoples and others who have suffered injustice. Maybe we're holding out for peace in Afghanistan, as Margaret just prayed for. Maybe we're holding out for financial stability. Some of us during this pandemic have found that difficult. Others of us haven't, but maybe for some who are listening, that's a real concern. What are we holding on to? What are we holding on to in terms of our hope? And in this passage, the writer of this letter says that we hold on to the hope we profess in Christ. In fact, the whole letter, as we've been looking at it, is one big call, isn't it, to spur one another on with confidence and with hope, especially in tough times, especially when there's a challenge or a temptation to let go and go back to the old ways of doing things, to give up on Jesus. In the context of the first letter, as I said, the readers, they were being tempted or challenged to give up on Jesus completely. And as we've been working through the letter, there's so much there that the writer is reminding us about to hold on to Jesus, to not give up, to hold on to this faith that they had proclaimed. The letter has some pretty stark challenges as well, not to let their hearts be hardened, not to miss out on rest, as we looked at before. And these amazing warnings in there mixed with amazing encouragement. The chapters before this passage, in those that we've looked at over the last few weeks, we've looked at the amazing truth that Jesus fulfills the role of the high priest. The high priest in the order of Melchizedek, if you remember a few weeks ago. But more than that, he's both our high priest and our perfect sacrifice. So the character, the role, the work of Jesus is evidence of this new covenant, this new life that these people had declared was going to be their new way of life, their new faith. Here we see through this letter that this new covenant, this new way of life is mediated only by Christ, by Jesus, who is far better, if we remember right to the start of the letter, far better than the angels, far better than Moses, the person who God gave the first kind of major covenant of the law to. Here we see Jesus, the final mediator of the true, the new covenant. We might underestimate that, but I think as we read through Hebrews, we get this glimpse of how dramatically transformative that was for the people back then, and hopefully for us as well, how transformative that is in our lives, in the way that we live. If you think through what these first verses are that Ricard read to us, we see this confidence. It's amazing confidence to enter into the most holy place, the most precious place where we experience the presence of God because of the blood of Jesus, this new and living way, the writer says. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. This is far better than the kind of sacramental washing or baptism that they used to experience. This is confidence to enter the very presence of God because of Jesus. If we believe in Jesus, we can experience this confidence and this assurance too. And so it's on that basis that we get to the next verse that says, hold on to these truths. Let us hold unswervingly to this hope that we profess. For he who promised, our covenant God, is faithful. And let us spur one another on, the writer continues. What does that mean, to hold on to the hope that we profess? In the time that we've got today, I just want to draw a few insights, I think, that have kind of sat with me and hopefully are encouragement and a challenge to us as a church and as a community and individuals holding on to faith. I'm not a Greek scholar at all, but I've had a look at what these terms mean, and one of the ways that the term holding on unswervingly was used was about kind of holding on when you were sailing. I like this image of this crew working together to hold on to a course unswervingly, to keep secure, to keep possession of. This idea to hold a ship steady, to hold a course and go for it. We see that in the other parts of the New Testament, where it, and in Hebrews as well, which we'll look at in a few weeks' time, when the author says, you know, fix your eyes on Jesus and keep steady, keep on that course. What does it mean for us to hold unswervingly to this hope? For me, I think it's important that we see that it's let me hold unswervingly individually. It's hard to hold on by yourself. But here we see that it's a community of faith, holding on together, encouraging one another together, being, I guess, warned together. Don't give up. Hold on. There's this commitment, isn't there? Like, we've started this journey together, we're going to complete it together with a clear direction, a clear purpose, a clear destination. Now, to hold on unswervingly gives us a sense that there's the possibility of swerving, hey? Maybe going off course, off track. And so if we hold on unswervingly, we're going to be watchful and correct our course when needed. We're going to think about what that means to hold each other accountable, to invite others to hold us accountable, to encourage us, to help us hold on to the faith, to the hope that we profess. But that's done in relationship. It's done through responsibility, shared responsibility, through shared effort. And I like that image of the ship, because it reminds me, not only am I not a Greek scholar, but I'm also not a sailor, so forgive me for those who know more than me, but holding steady is important in both calm and storm. Like, if you've got a destination, definitely that's important when it's stormy and you've really got to hold on and struggle against the waves, but it's just as important to get to your destination when things are calm as well. We hold on unswervingly. And we hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess. In some versions, and you might have other versions of the Bible at home or on your phone or whatever you're using, sometimes it talks about the confession of our hope. What is our hope? We've looked at that already through the letter that this writer has written to these people, of kind of this historical hope, historical faith in a covenant God. And here we see it's reminded that our hope is based in a person, based in Jesus Christ. Our security is founded in Jesus. It's hope that is shared. And so when we profess our hope, when we make a confession of our hope, we're saying that we believe in a God who speaks and acts in this world. We believe in a God who hears us. We believe in a God who shows us mercy and grace. We believe in a God who through Jesus has gone before us, who has been our sacrifice, who is our high priest. And we believe in a God whose Spirit is with us to help us do all of these things that God has called us to do. We profess in a hope that has a future, that has a destination, that has an end goal in some ways. We hold on unswervingly to this hope that we profess because he who promised is faithful. I love this. It's not just up to me. It's not just up to like my own strength or my own sense of commitment, although they're important. They're part of the holding on. But ultimately, and we saw that in those first verses, we hold on because we have confidence and assurance in Jesus. This faithful covenant character of God that we've been reading about and hearing about. God will do what he has promised. For the original listeners of this letter, readers of this letter, that faithfulness is seen in Jesus, the long-awaited Messiah. That promise resonates through the whole of the Jewish scriptures. And here we must have had, for the first readers, if you can imagine, this sense of, my goodness, the promise has come in the person of Jesus. For generations and generations, they've been longing, waiting for a Messiah. And here the writer says, don't give up. Jesus is the fulfillment of that promise. Hold on to Jesus. Know God's promises. Experience his faithfulness. Live out the reality of that through the power of the Holy Spirit. It's an amazing warning, I think, that there's swerving that could happen, and hold on, but an amazing encouragement as well. Because in the end, that holding on makes sense. We have the strength through Christ, and through God's grace, to do it together. And so what does that look like for us? What does it look like for us as a community of faith? What might it have looked like for the readers of the past? What does it mean? For the writer of this letter, they always mix some high theological truth with really grounded, practical ways of letting it flow out. And isn't that what we should do? That our belief, our theological faith should actually shape our actions, that there's kind of that interplay. And so the writer says this, let us consider then how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. We don't just sit there thinking, oh, that's great, I'm holding on to the promise, I'm holding on to the hope for our own sake. No, we agitate others for love and good deeds. We push people on. We kind of say, come on, get on with it. Live a life of faith. Not because of legalism, not because we think we need to do that to get away from our sin or our guilt. The earlier parts of this passage have told us Jesus has dealt with that. We have a clear conscience. It starts with God, and all of this is a response to what God has done. In community, let us consider how we may spur one another on. For those of you who've read the New Testament, you'll know that other writers have lots of one another passages as well. What does it mean to live in relationship with one another, to partner with God in this? What might it look like to spur one another on towards love and good deeds, to our character and our action, reflecting this hope that we profess? The writer suggests one thing as well, that the people of reading this letter, and for us as well, that we shouldn't give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. Now, I know when I'm saying this to you guys in YouTube land, and a few people here in church, it kind of feels a bit strange to say that. Don't give up meeting together. But I think there's a deeper relevance, isn't there, in that? In the context of this letter, meeting together was a sign of your commitment to each other, to your holding on. To stay connected was part of committing your faith and your life to Jesus. In the midst of suffering and persecution, which we know was happening as we read the letter, meeting together was risky. It had confirmed allegiance and identity into this new community. And so for the original readers, meeting together was a really important sign of identity. And maybe it is for us as well. When we're tempted to drift away, one of the first things we do is we disconnect from our brothers and sisters of faith. So what might it mean for us not to give up meeting together? I think it's much more than just making sure that you're here on a Sunday or logged on a Sunday. I think it's that about that relationship that we have with each other as this part of this faith community. What does it mean to stay in relationship with one another, to hold on together, to experience faith together, to experience all the messiness and the brokenness and the weakness of Christian community, to experience all the beauty and the wholeness and the strength of Christian community. Don't give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, the writer says, but encourage one another. Encourage one another. And there's a sense of urgency in some ways. Encourage one another, as all the more as you see the day, big capital D, day, approaching. There's this encouragement and this challenge, isn't it, for us? This is timely. Don't put it off. Keep encouraging one another all the more as you see the day approaching. Now, that day isn't like 70% vaccination rates or something like that. It speaks to that much bigger day of God's judgment, of God's culmination of his plan. Earlier on, we've seen the writer say, encourage one another daily as long as it's called today. And now they remind their readers that there's this bigger day coming when this full realization of God's redemptive plan will be evident to us. Because of that day, spur one another on. Hold on, that's the destination. Let's get there together. Now, if we jump to the end of the chapter, it's a really long chapter, and I chose not to go through it all, so I've just kind of given you a glimpse, but I encourage you, read all of chapter 10. But at the end, we see, again, this challenge and an encouragement. Don't shrink back. Hold on. The writer says this, remember those earlier days after you received the light, when you endured in great conflict, full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that yourselves had better and lasting possessions. Don't throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. Can you see the echoes of what the writer is saying here that we've seen all the way through Hebrews? You need to persevere, the writer says, so that when you've done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But by my righteousness, one will live by faith, and I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back. And then the writer says this, but we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. The writer says, we're the ones who hold on. Keep holding on. Don't shrink back. Hold on. Don't shrink back. What does that look like for us as a community here at MacChap? What does it mean to us to belong to those who don't let go? If you think about it, been thinking through some of the practical things that Dave and others have been talking about throughout this series. Holding on means that we're working hard to develop strength and maturity individually and together, that we're thinking about what our witness is into the world, that we're not waiting for it all to be perfect. We're getting on with the job. We're holding on now. We're encouraging one another. We're spurring one another on towards love and good deeds. How might we put that into practice? I've got a few suggestions, and I know that it's always good to give you guys some homework. And so to finish, I wanted to suggest some things that we might do. You might want to do one of these this week. To take some time to read through the first 10 chapters. Now, it's not a short letter, right? So read through those first 10 chapters again and just be reminded about how much Jesus has done for us and how God has been faithful to his promises. You might want to share a passage of scripture with someone to encourage them. You might want to do something practical to show love and grace to someone else. That might be somebody within our faith community at MacChap. It might be someone else that maybe doesn't know God yet, but helping them experience God's love and God's grace. You might know of some people who have stopped meeting together. Some people who maybe have found this period really hard, not just in practical ways, but also for their faith. I encourage you, connect with that person. Reach out to them. See how they're going. Encourage them. Remind them again of the faith they once held. And in doing so, I guess that means that we're vulnerable, hey? There's a vulnerability in all of this as we hold on together. And so I know Dave talked about this a few weeks ago as well, to allow ourselves to be accountable to each other, to be accountable to someone, for someone to be able to say to me, how are you holding on? How's that going? Why haven't you been doing this, or why are you doing that? And then being vulnerable and open and trusting enough within faith and within safety to be able to actually say to that person, this is where I am at the moment. What might it be like for us as a community of faith to live out this holding unswervingly to the hope we profess? For he who promised is faithful. Let me pray. Our holy and gracious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Lord, we thank you for who you are, for your faithfulness to us, for your faithfulness to your people throughout all generations. We thank you that we are people who have experienced your grace and your redemption. We thank you that we can have confidence and assurance because of you. God, I pray that we won't throw that away, that we'll hold it as precious, and that we'll hold that together. Lord, help us hold unswervingly to the hope that we have. Help us to fix our eyes on Jesus, to stay true to the declarations of our faith. And Lord, help us to be gracious and kind and loving to those who struggle with this. Lord, as we spur one another on towards love and good deeds, I pray that that is shaped by your love and your good deeds to us, your mercy and your grace and your truth. Lord, we thank you that we don't have to do this alone, but that we have your Holy Spirit with us, in us, alive and active in our community. And so, Lord, please continue to be with us and give us the strength to hold on for our sake and for your glory and for your kingdom's cause. Amen.
Spare us, we win.
With voices united.
of true worship we raise.
Our sins now confessing, we pray for your blessing.
To you, our great Redeemer, forever be praised.
Well, thank you for this morning, Gail. And thank you for joining us. Let me just pray for our offertory. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for the reminder of that this morning. We thank you for the sure hope that we have. We thank you for a Saviour who has cleansed us. And as we think about all the things that you have done for us, especially through your Son Jesus, we ask, Heavenly Father, the gifts that we give to you might be given freely as a response to what you've done. They might be used for the extension of your kingdom and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Will the Lord bless you and keep you, and the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Jim, thanks for coming along. Which service do you attend and how long have you been attending Macquarie Chapel?
Well, let me think for a moment, Andrew. Oh, I've been attending this church since about 1970. When we came back from Brisbane, where I'd been on a transfer with the company I was with, rather than go back to my mother church at Gladesville, where I'd been since I was a toddler, with a growing family, it was more appropriate that we went to a more local church so that the children could enjoy church with children they would probably be going to school with. So as far as Presbyterianism is concerned, that is really significantly in my blood, because my father and mother worshipped at Gladesville. As it turned out, my mother-in-law and father-in-law-to-be worshipped at Gladesville. So did my late wife, and so did my great-grandparents, on the basis that Samuel Jordan on my mother's side, had come to Australia from Northern Ireland, and he was a dedicated Presbyterian Northern Irishman. I don't think they're probably even more dedicated than the Scots. And he'd been worshipping at St. Anne's in Wright and worked heaven and earth to get a church in Glasville, and that's how it all happened. So I've only really worshipped in three churches, at St. Andrew's at Glasville, at St. Andrew's in Ironsides in Brisbane, and Macquarie Presbyterian Church. So that's sort of my background. And 8:30 is my service because it's four hymns, reading and a couple of prayers and a 20-minute sermon.
Fantastic. Thanks, Jim. What are two or one or two of the big moments in your spiritual life?
Looking back, I suppose there are many minor ones, but a major one, I suppose, was the first rally that I went to, and it was the first one, I think, in Sydney, when Billy Graham came to town. The amount of organisation, the amount of fervour, excitement, churches all over Sydney were organising buses to take us there, and we were not disappointed. I've never heard such a dynamic sermon, been with such an enthusiastic crowd of people, and I would say to a person, everybody was moved, including myself and my two then quite small boys. And it was just one of those, as much as I enjoyed church and knew church, that was a very, very uplifting experience, and I'll never forget it, never forget it. And in fact, I went to all these rallies. I hope it made me a better person, but it certainly was an awakening of the true everyday meaning of Christianity. That's the second one was more personal in the sense that I'd been invited to be an elder of this church. And I was very honoured and humbled to be asked. But the actual ceremony of induction, when the other elders, and we had a very big eldership then, because I think there was about 18 or 20 of us, and it was right there. And at a particular moment in that service, each of the elders were asked to place their hands upon me. And you know how sometimes you feel a movement in your body when something you hear or see happens, or you think about? Well, that particular moment, there were my now equals in this church, taking the trouble and the time to pray for me and put their hands upon me, welcoming as one, and that was a significant moment, a very significant moment. Plus the fact, in those days, you were told if you accepted the challenge of eldership and the responsibility, it was yours for life. So hence the emeritus tag that's now placed on those too old to sort of play an active part. So those are the two most significant things in my Christian life.
Thanks, Jim. You mentioned becoming an elder. Approximately when did you actually become an elder?
I beg your pardon?
You mentioned becoming an elder. Approximately when did you become an elder?
It would have been in the early 80s, I believe. We'd been here since the 1970s or so, when we came back to Sydney when Alison was very, very ill. And my company that I worked for at the time were very understanding and made that possible. And so I'd been part of the work of the church, and I suppose it would have been in the early 80s. There's a picture hanging up in, well, what used to be the crying room, which was originally the minister's office when this was built in 1978. And there's a picture of us all. And it was quite a number of ladies were in the eldership then too, because this has always been a church that made sure that the women of the church, the backbone of the church in many ways, played an active role.
Thanks. Why are you an elder, and why do you think it's important for Macquarie Chapel to have elders?
Well, Andrew, I think it's not only in the tradition of the church, but every church has a similar sort of group of people. And any group that you're part of, you look for people who at times of need you look to. You look to people who would be leaders in your group, if you're not one of them. And that's what eldership is about. It's to keep an eye on the flock, not be proselytising to them all the time, but when the need arises, to be an open ear, to keep things very private, because sometimes people come to you with worries that are not for general publication, but are desperate to tell you something that they feel they can't tell anybody else. So it's an incredible position of trust. Now, they don't come to me every week like Edward the Confessor or something. It rarely happens. But when it does, you have to be prepared for it, not be judgmental. And sometimes you feel like being so, but it's to be a confidential ear and to often seek people out that you see need that help. It might be just to pick them up and come to church, or it might be a friendly word because you know they're hurting for some reason or other, and to enjoy themselves when they're enjoying themselves. So it's a marvellous thing to be in any leadership group, but particularly in this church, and to see the profound changes that are occurring. One of which is, of course, adding Macquarie Chapel, which I think is very jingoistic and it shouldn't be there, but I can understand the reason for it. And I'm not a happy clappy, but I see the need for that too, because it reaches out to a generation that is part of their daily life, the way they enjoy themselves and participate. So basically, that's me.
Okay, thanks, Jim. As an elder, how can we go about praying for you?
Oh, Andrew, I don't know. Just ask God to continue to be kind to me. When you're my age, every day's a bonus. Like an old car, there's always something going wrong, and you can't just nick down to Repco and buy a box and plug it in and fix it up. So it's all those little things that you don't really pray for yourself so much. And so any prayers that might help me along the way would be most gratefully received.
Thanks very much, Jim. Thanks for coming back in again. And I'm sure people have enjoyed having a listen to what you've had to say. Thank you.
Thanks for the opportunity.
Appreciate it.